Hello there, good afternoon. You're watching Proactive London. Paul Baay from Touchstone Exploration is joining us this afternoon once again, because you were joining us for our Proactive one-to-one investor forum last week. And as usual, we've had a spillover of questions from your investors that we're going to go through this afternoon, one by one. Lots of interest. I think we had more than 100. So we've sort of broken these down into main topics. And we'll get cracking, shall we, Paul?
That'll be great. Appreciate the time today.
Let's go for it, shall we? So this investor wants to know, so in October, your initial announcement on Chinook indicated significant levels of natural gas, but the follow-up announcement at the end of March referred only to minor amounts of light oil. Can you explain how this apparent contradiction came about and what the next steps are at Chinook?
Yeah, the real short answer is no, I can't totally explain it. You know, with what we saw on the electronic logs, it looked like there was hydrocarbon there. When we were drilling, we actually experienced gas at surface. And then when we went and did the completion, as you mentioned in the press release, we just saw minor amounts of oil. So it's really one of two things. We either damaged the well when we drilled it and the gas can't get out of the reservoir, or two, the gas was there at some point, the logs picked up the residual amount of hydrocarbon that was there, and it's migrated to somewhere else in the structure. So we've got to figure that out. And that's what we told everybody, is give us a little bit of time. We put a pump on the well, we pumped the well, it's now been shut in, we'll get some pressure data, and then it should go back on pump this week. So, you know, I think it's a disappointment. There's no question about that. And we went to Baker, we went to Schlumberger, we've gone to local talent. So we're still trying to figure this one out, but that's part of exploration for sure, unfortunately.
Yeah, quite right. Maybe this one here then. Could you clarify whether the 25 to 30 million standard cubic feet per day mentioned at the Cascadura Deep would be the total output or the output per well?
Yeah, I think when I listened back on that, I was probably going a little fast for myself on that one. The first well is going to be about 40 million cubic feet a day. So that's the first Cascadura well we drilled. The second Cascadura well itself is going to be in the range of probably that 20 to 30. So when you put those together, you know, we're still looking at something where we're going to be bringing on 60 to 70, depending on how the wells perform, maybe up to 80 million cubic feet a day when those come on. And that target's still for later this year.
Okay, Paul, this next one here is, would it be correct to say that Cascadura Deep and Cascadura 1 wells are basically separate discoveries?
Yes, it would be. It would be correct to say that. They're actually in two different sheets of the same horizon. And what we found in the tests is both by the pressure data and the makeup of the condensate, they are very distinct. So if you think of them as two different pools, and what that really does is that gives us the advantage now of we can actually explore them as two pools, even though they're in one area. So it kind of doubled the inventory of development wells that we have at Cascadura with those results. And I'm not sure, because of the, you know, the negative news that came out on Chinook, I'm not sure everybody fully appreciated how significant Cascadura Deep really was for us.
Moving on here to Coho. So there have been some delays at Coho. Can you update us on how this is progressing and how you plan to mitigate these delays going forward?
Yeah, it's one of these things that's a little bit out of our hands. So the deal is we sell our gas to the National Gas Company. The National Gas Company then takes it and moves it onto the market. Part of what they need to do is they need to cut a deal with Shell, who has the plant to the south of us, and to run the gas through that plant, because it's the most efficient way to get the gas to market. They have not, as of yet, finalized that deal with Shell. So we've all agreed, let's just wait until that gets finalized. It gives them a lot more ability to negotiate a good deal, as opposed to Shell with all the leverage. So that's just kind of what we're doing. The other alternative there with Coho that they've talked about is actually where we would go around Shell. So we wouldn't go through Shell, we'd actually go around them. That may be a little bit longer from a timing point of view. But the real positive of that is we have no restrictions on the amount of gas that we could sell out of Coho. So it could accelerate our development plan at Coho. We could look at some of the deeper prospects at Coho to bring those on stream. So again, I think it's one of these ones where it's going to slow things down, but there could be some real upside potential for it for sure.
This next person just wants a bit more clarity on the timeline at Coho. So they're asking, are the delays at Coho an indication that we probably shouldn't expect production from Cascadura in the fourth quarter of 2021?
Yeah, you know, that question I think is a real obvious one is, you know, if you can't get Coho on, you know, are you going to get delayed with Cascadura? The major difference between the two is there's no Shell involved at Cascadura. So it's the National Gas Company taking the gas right from us and tying into their existing system. So that one big variable has been taken off the table. And so, no, I think Cascadura is probably more predictable right now, in my opinion, than Coho, just because of that third variable in the equation at Coho.
Queries on Royston now then. So what is the potential size of Royston? Are you on schedule for the drill? And what is the plan for when it's finished?
Yeah, so Royston, you know, it's always been the largest prospect that we've had to drill. And we saved it till the end of phase one for two reasons. One is we want to make sure that we had the technology to drill it with the rig we had. But number two, it's the furthest one away from market too. So, but it is by far the largest prospect. If you look back, it's basically bigger than everything we've drilled combined to date, to give kind of a size magnitude. You know, we think it could be up to a TCF of gas on its own. So it's very, very large. It's virtually an offshore type gas field onshore. As far as timing goes, yeah, we've, you know, we're finishing up on the road. The rig's supposed to move in this month. And the idea would be to drill it in, you know, the end of May, June. It's gonna drill into July. And our hope would be we'd have the results to the market at the end of July.
Okay, this one is more of a summary style question. Do you plan any more exploration for 2021, or is the focus on getting wells into production?
Definitely the focus is on getting the wells into production, and mainly just because we want to have the cash so that we can accelerate the program. So that's part of it. And the other part is we've made a long-term commitment on a new rig that's coming in from North America. It's going to really save us a bunch of money, be much more efficient. There's a bunch of things we can do with it. It's not arriving probably till later this year. So what we'd really like to do is gear that program up to later this year. Having said that, if things go well and, you know, oil prices stay where they are, don't forget, we've still got base oil production that's generating a bunch of cash, especially at almost $70 a barrel. Then what we would do is we look at it at dropping an additional well into the program. We also want to make sure Royston doesn't go over budget. It's a $7 million project. So being a little cautious, but we've got some plan Bs, Cs and Ds on the back end of that as well.
Okay. This one is asking about the Kraken prospects here. I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly. Could you maybe run us through the seismic program there for this project?
Yeah, and again, this is really, I think, you know, what people and investors, potential investors and shareholders really need to focus on is some of the stuff that we've got going forward. I mean, this Kraken prospect sits underneath Royston. And right now we're drilling or shooting about a 21-kilometer seismic program that'll help define the development of Royston if it's successful. But it'll also really help us with this big Cretaceous structure. And it's... this is going to sound like I'm repeating myself, but it's again bigger than Royston. So it's a larger prospect, it's deeper. You know, it's kind of equivalent to some of the stuff that's being drilled offshore by Exxon and those in that Guyana basin. And it's something Exxon has chased in Trinidad before. It's obviously a concept that everybody has. We have a really unique situation at Royston geologically. And that's why we think it's a great opportunity and one that we're not going to leave behind.
Great. Paul Baay, always a pleasure from Touchstone Exploration here on Proactive London, answering your shareholder questions today. Thank you for your time.
Really appreciate it. Thanks, Katie.